Thank you. And part of these talks, joint works with Jonathan Kellner and David Storer. In particular, I want to thank David Storer for much of these joint works, as well as co-authoring the survey that is in the proceedings with me. And just as a warning, this almost nothing that I will say will be 100% correct. So you can read the survey in the proceedings for a more accurate description. So I'll try to give everything that I'll say will be kind of morally true, but not technically true. So I'm pretty sure that I will make some experts cringe during this talk, and apologize in advance. So generally, the space of algorithms is very rich. There are many, many different algorithms out there. And as a rule, you have, for every different problem, you design a different algorithm. And it requires a significant, non-trivial amount of creativity to design an algorithm for a problem. So given that, there are so many algorithms, so many potential algorithms, and it seems like a kind of a crazy notion to want to have a single algorithm for all possible problems. But it might not be so completely far-fetched. In some sense, it is obviously true, but not really true. Some true in some vacuous way, because you can always find a single algorithm that would solve all problems for which there is an efficient algorithm that solves them by just enumerating over all possible Turing machines. So for some kind of silly reason, there is a single algorithm that works for all problems, that solves all problems, say all combinatorial optimization problems for which that could be potentially solved. But this is not somehow, so this idea of having one algorithm for all problems, that's not a very satisfying answer. But the deeper reason is that if you actually go and open one of those algorithms books, you see that there are a few principles that seem to underlie many of the algorithms that we have. So in some sense, it might well be that there is an optimal algorithm for interesting classes of problems. So this would be kind of the hope, to have a single algorithm that, maybe not for all problems, but for a very significant class of them, would be optimal, in the sense that if that algorithm doesn't solve it, then no efficient algorithm can solve it. And why do we care about something like that? So it will give us a unified approach to understanding which problems are easy and which problems are hard. Generally, showing that a problem is easy, analyzing algorithms is a very challenging endeavor, as well as proving that a certain problem is hard is also very challenging. In particular, we don't know how to do it without assuming something such as P different than NP, but even under this assumption, this is still hard. So, and if we had this kind of optimal algorithm for a large class of problems, then to show that the problem is hard, it would be enough for us to show that this algorithm doesn't solve it, and that is much easier than ruling out all possible algorithms. And maybe more deeper reason why we want to find this kind of optimal algorithm that would be best efficient algorithm out there for a class of problems, is that this would give us an understanding of why a problem is easy or why it is hard, as opposed to just a laundry list of, this is an algorithmic result, this is a hardness reduction that tells you if a problem is easy or hard, but doesn't really explain to you the underlying reason. So we are kind of searching for a unified explanation to try to separate which problems are easy and which problems are hard. So this is the hope of finding an optimal meta-algorithm, and to quote a juggler I once saw at Union Square, if you just joined us now, everything until now has been bullshit, so you didn't miss anything. We're just talking about a hope of finding one optimal meta-algorithm, an algorithm that for some class of problems, if there exists an efficient algorithm, then this algorithm will solve the problem. And I'm going to talk about one particular algorithm that might have this property for a particular class of problems which we still don't particularly understand. And this is the sum of squares algorithm. So this is a generic kind of meta algorithm that can be applied for many problems in polynomial, generally for that can be cast as polynomial optimization. We'll explain what that means later. And it has been discovered independently by researchers from several communities, in particular Shoal, Nahum Shoal, Stero, Corillo, Lacer. And it is an algorithmic version of results that are related to Hilbert's 17 problem in a real algebraic geometry. And the underlying principle of this algorithm is that an efficient way to prove that a function is non-negative is to represent it as a sum of squares. And it's widely used in many applications, including analyzing system, analyzing real-world things such as planes and quantum information theory and various other areas. And it is a generalization of many known algorithms. So in some sense, it encapsulates many other algorithms can be shown to be just a special case of this algorithm. And empirically, it seems to work very well. As I said, it's used in many applications, but the theoretical analysis is not so strong at the moment. And there are many results analyzing it, showing that it converges eventually if you run it for enough time, but not so many results that show that it converges efficiently and gives a good answer, say, within polynomial time. But see also Monique's talk in this conference for more of this. And the question we want to ask is whether this can be an optimal meta-algorithm, and because it generalizes many known algorithms and it seems very, very natural approach, it seems maybe possible that it could be a meta-algorithm, and we're not going to answer this question or even precisely formulate it because we still don't know how. But I will say a little bit of what we know about this algorithm. Okay, so this is what I'm going to talk about this in this talk. So I'm going to, and again, also if you just came and you missed the warning, nothing that I'm going to say is going to be correct. Everything is going to be morally correct. So I'm going to describe two views of this sum of squares algorithm. One is in the view of proof system, sum of squares proofs, or also called positive Stanislas proofs. And the other view is pseudo distributions. I'm going to talk about a particular application, a dictionary learning application that's also known as sparse coding. And at the end, I'll talk about the relation to Subhashkot's Unigames conjecture. And if you're wondering what these images are, some of them will be explained, some of them won't, so you can ask me after the talk. Okay, so the problem that we are trying to solve is the problem of polynomial equations. We've given a set of equations of the form P of X is, say, larger than something, and of course, inequalities in particular imply you can also phrase equalities as two inequalities. And we want to find the solution for this system of polynomial equations or prove that none exists. And this is a very, very general framework. You know, if we restrict to degree one, then this is linear programming. If we just look at one polynomial that is quadratic, this is like least squares or eigenvalues. If we have many polynomials and they are non-linear, then we can basically capture great many of the problems that we are interested in computer science, and some of these problems are NP-hard, and here is an example. So suppose we have given a graph, and a graph G, so if I define the equations xi squared equals xi for every I, then that enforces that xi has to be either 0 or 1, And then if I add the conditions that xi xj equals 0 for every ij that is an edge, and that the sum of the xi's is equal or at least k, then that is equivalent to the graph containing what's known as an independent set, or also sometimes known as a stable set of size k. That is a set such as this set that will know a set that doesn't contain an edge in it. So for example, for this graph, we would get these kind of equations. So if you could solve these equations, you would find an independent set in the graph, and since that is an NP-hard problem, we someone know that you're not going to be able to efficiently solve this general problem of polynomial equations, and you can use similar encoding to encode many, many other problems. So it's a very, very general tool, or very general framework to describe computational problems. And this is the problem that basically the sum of squares algorithm is trying to solve. So at a high level view, what the sum of squares algorithm does, and I'm sure Monique in her talk will give actually a much more detailed view of it, is that given some parameter d, which we think of as a degree or quality parameter, and a set of equations, it either finds something that I will call a degree d pseudo solution, which will be explained later, or it proves that no solution exists. And these pseudo solutions are a relaxation of actual solutions in the sense that an actual solution is a degree d pseudo solution for every d, and as d grows and grows, it becomes closer in some kind of sense that I'm not going to describe in some logical sense to the actual solution. And the running time of the algorithm is n to the d. So if you want more quality of a solution, you increase d. It costs you more time, but you get something that is, in some sense, less pseudo and more real. And because the problem is NP-hard, we know that sometimes we will need d that is very large. In particular, this actually can be proven even, that we sometimes will need d that is omega of n, which means it will take it exponential time for the algorithm to find, for the pseudo solution to have to be anything resembling an actual solution. And
so
when
you have an m.
What?
You have an m in the
input. Yes, let's think of m equals n or O of n. Think of m as equal n or O of n. So think of them as more or less the same number. So often we will need like d to be linear in n, so which means exponential time, or sometimes we will need that, but it seems to run faster empirically, at least in some cases, but we still don't really understand these cases. And the hope is that for some natural class, which I still don't know exactly how to, what natural means, it will, if there is some polynomial time algorithm to solve it, then it will actually converge very fast with only constant d. And there is some evidence, some intuition for this, but this is really, we still don't even have the right conjecture yet. And what I'm going to talk about is, next is these two terms that I didn't define. What does it mean to be a pseudo solution? And what does it mean to be a proof that no solution exists? And I'll actually start with the second thing. So what does it mean to be a proof that no solution exists? So sum of squares proof is a very simple system to deduce polynomial inequalities from other inequalities. You only use the following two rules. You know that if p is non-negative and q is non-negative, then p plus q is also, and p times q are also non-negative. And you know that the square is always non-negative. So you only, so you basically use these two rules to deduce new inequalities from all inequalities. And we say that we have proof as degree d if you never use in all this process a polynomial of degree larger than d. And there is this issue of static proofs versus dynamic, which I'm going to brush under the carpet in this talk, but it doesn't make a difference. So these are sum of squares proofs. Obviously, these are two correct rules of inference, so what you prove using sum of squares proofs is a correct statement. And the main theorem that basically this sum of squares algorithm is the theorem that you can find proofs in n to the d times. If there exists a degree d proof, you can actually find it. in n to the d time, and this uses semi-definite programming. And another very basic result is known as the positive Stellensatz, which is that every true statement about polynomial inequalities actually has a degree d proof. It just might be a very large d. It depends on the statement. And so that means, that may mean that this sum of squares theorem might not be so useful, because maybe you always need huge degree, but it seems to be actually very useful, and many many standard things that we like to prove, like Cauchy-Schwarz, Wolder, etc., and even some fancier things, some of them we heard about already in Subhash's talk, and like majority stabilist theorem, etc. Many of those things actually are captured by low degree sum of squares proofs. And in fact, we don't really know of very good examples. The only way, in some sense, the only way we know to really show that something cannot be proven by a small degree sum of squares is to use the probabilistic method. So this is, again, not completely true, but in some sense, if you want robustly requiring larger degree, then it does seem to be the state of art. So we don't really know. We have very few examples of things that actually require. So much of what mathematicians do seem to be captured by low-degree sum of squares proofs. And so now this is what it means that a proof that no solution exists to a set of equations is to show that these equations imply the inequality minus one is larger than zero. So if we derive minus one larger than zero from the inequalities p1 larger than 0 to pm larger than 0, that means that there is no solution into this thing. So I've specified the second thing. Now we know what it means to prove that no solution exists. Now what does it mean to be a pseudo-solution? So that's a little trickier. So intuitively, a pseudo-solution, what we attempted to model using it is our computational knowledge on the solutions. So how much information do we know after we run for n to the d time about the solution? And as we allow ourselves to run more and more in more and more time, our computational knowledge converges to the actual true knowledge, to the best the actual solution. And to define it, I'll first do a detour and define statistical knowledge using actual distributions, and then define what it's pseudo-solutions using computational knowledge using what I call pseudo-distributions. So modeling knowledge as a distribution is very standard in, say, economics, optimization, machine learning. And the idea is the following. Suppose I pick some arbitrary string x, and I gradually reveal to you information about it. So I pick this x in the Boolean cube, and I tell you more and more facts about x. So initially, so I can capture your knowledge of x as some distribution over the potential values of x from your perspective. So basically, initially, you don't know anything. So you can say that you, as far as you're concerned, the x is uniform in 0, 1 to the n. But then I tell you more. So I tell you that maybe the sum of x's is larger than n over 2, so you know a little bit more. And then I tell you some more facts about x, and you learn more and more stuff, until eventually I tell you many, many pieces of information, and eventually maybe you find out exactly, you rule everything out, and you find out exactly what x is. And these pictures are not exactly right, but I think you get the picture. So the question is, can we do the same for computational knowledge? The tricky thing about computational knowledge is that you actually get all the information about x, but it's just that you don't really know x because you're computationally bounded, so you can't make all possible logical inferences from the information that you already received. So can we still model your knowledge of x as a distribution, even though in some sense I already gave you all the information? So this is what we're trying to do. So I give you all the information about x, but somehow in a way that is computationally hard to decode. So start to say it's a little bit opaque. So for example, I give you a graph G that x is the unique maximum independent set of G. So in information theoretically this completely determines x, but if I gave it to you, so if I gave you this graph and I didn't tell you where the independent set is, then you would probably not be able to find that, to tell me what x is. And I want to find, come up with some distribution-like object to kind of model your knowledge of x after you spent n to the d computation steps churning on this graph. And what do you know? So for example, you already, there are some things that you immediately know. You know that, like maybe you don't know what x is, but you know that either 1 is in x, or you know, either x1 is equal to 1 or x2 is equal to 1, but not both of them. So you do know some things, and kind of want to capture what you know. And the sum of squares approach to do it is to try to model what you know after n to the d steps by saying that you can draw all possible degree d inferences, but not more than that. So we define a pseudo distribution that is consistent with a set of equations to be a set of numbers where you define one number for every polynomial, which we call the expectation of p of s, even though s is not really a distribution. So we define this number, and the condition that we want is that for every degree d inference that you can draw from this set of equations e, the actual, if you manage to infer that the polynomial should be non-negative, the expectation of this polynomial should be non-negative. So this is a little bit of a weird object, and maybe I'm not describing it, describing it in the technically simplest way, but more in the morally somehow justifiable way. And in particular, like this looks like a very complicated object, but you can show that this implies also linearity, and therefore this expectation operator should be linear. That means it can be specified by just n to the d numbers. You pick some basis for the polynomials, say the monomials, basis for the polynomials, and you just need to specify these numbers for the monomials and extend it linearly. So this object is just a vector of n to the d numbers. And what it needs to satisfy is this property, which you can show that it really means that some matrix related to this object is positive semi-definite. So this is what we use to somehow model computational knowledge. So we can argue, we can say things like, from your point of view, the expectation of x7 is half, or things like that, even though this is not really a distribution. And you give me a function that is not a degree d polynomial, then it's not well defined what is the expectation of f of s. The only thing I could do is truncate it to log the b polynomial and using Taylor or something like that and just give me this. So this is a definition of degree d pseudo distribution. And basically this is now what the sum of squares algorithm is. So the sum of squares algorithm is an algorithm that you give it a parameter d, and if time n to the d, it will either give you, and you give it as input, a set of equations e, and it will either give you a derivation, a degree d derivation of minus one larger than zero, which is a proof that this set of equations is inconsistent, or it will give you a degree d pseudo distribution that is consistent with E, which means that it will pretend, in some sense, it will give you a pseudo distribution that pretends to be a distribution over solutions of E. And you can show that exactly one of those, under some technical conditions, exactly one of those will be true. So you either have, this is really just a strong duality of convex polynomial. So this is the sum of squares algorithm. And now I described it. Now let me show how we can use it to solve a problem. And the example application, it's actually kind of related to Candace's talk from this morning, dictionary learning or sparse coding. So suppose you get a set of unit vectors, and you're given many linear combinations of them, but linear combinations that are sparse. So there are some random variables w1 to wm, and you're given y that is drawn as some wiai, but the WIs are sparse. The probability that they are non-zero is much smaller than that. And the intuition, why this is an interesting problem to try to recover the AIs from such an examples, is that this should be like the right representation of this data wide. In the right representation, it should be sparse. So in some sense, if you were to listen to maybe a lot of sounds and you would do that, you would recover the Fourier basis. If you were, and generally, if you were to say, look at many pictures of faces, then you would recover a basis that is linear basis that is good for representing faces. And if you're trying to ask questions such as, you know, is this a face of a man or a woman, it might be better to work with this basis than, say, the pixel basis or some other basis. And there is lots of work about this problem. It's an important primitive in machine learning, vision, neuroscience. There's some Olsen and Field that started this question, argue that maybe this is what the brain does. And there are heuristics that seem to work very well, but, you know, of course, as a theorist, we're not interested in, you know, a heuristic that runs fast and produces good results. We want a slow algorithm that we can prove something about. So, and that's not so developed. So the previous best rigorous results require the vector to be very sparse, to be less than one over square root n sparse. And interestingly, the tools that they use are the tools that actually, in other problems, these are exactly the tools that Candace talk about. L1 minimizations and assumptions of incoherence, and this is somewhat of a simple, different problem than compressed sensing, in the sense that in compressed sensing the AIs are known, and here the AIs are not known. But on the other hand, here you get many examples, and in compressed sensing you only get, in some sense, just one linear combination. So it's somewhat of a dual problem. One result we had is that we use the sum of squares algorithm to improve upon these results. And this kind of shows that maybe this extra complexity of the sum of squares algorithm actually does give you more power over simpler convex programs like L1 minimization. And let me give you kind of a very cartoonish overview of the proof. So, idea is that we take these examples that we get, and we want to construct a polynomial such that optimizing of these polynomials will give us what we want. So we want to find a polynomial such that its global maxima are, over the unit sphere are basically these vectors that we're looking for. And just know that we will have no control. This will be a high degree polynomial, say degree 4 or something like that, or maybe even more. And we have no control over the local maximum, so it's optimizing over it. It's not clear that you can do it, because if you try any kind of local algorithm like gradient descent, etc., it might get stuck in a local local optimum. But still, we can find a polynomial like that. And then the crucial thing is to, after we found a polynomial like that and proved that it satisfies this property star, go back to our proof and see what actual arguments we used. And if we are lucky, we didn't use any argument that is not captured by low degree sum of squares. And then that actually means that a sum of squares algorithm will find these optimized, will be able to optimize over it. And this is, of course, not immediate, but basically what will happen is that if you have a pseudo distribution over the maximas of this polynomial, so pseudo distribution consistent with the constraint that it is a unit vector and it has large value for this polynomial, then it will actually be able to recover the AIs from this thing. And the crucial thing is just you have to have that the proof of star uses low degree sum squares algorithm. And the way we instantiate this idea is we actually choose. Which is more complicated things, but for starters, we choose the empirical variance of as p of x, the empirical variance of y dot x squared, where y is drawn from the distribution above. So, with many examples, we basically can the empirical variance is converges to the actual variance. So we get the variance of y dot x squared, and you can see, or at least intuitively, that if x was one of those AIs, then when the linear combination included AI, this dot product will be big, and when it doesn't, it will be small or average or moderate. So so when X is one of those AIs, the variance will be large, and when X is not one of those AIs, the variance will be small. So the global maxima of these polynomials will be the vectors that we're looking for. And then you go over the proof of the, this kind of informal argument that I said, and you show that really what I only was using is basic various kind of relations between norms, various kinds of P norms, LP norms that are captured by Holder type inequalities, and all these kind of relations have small low degree sum of squares arguments. So that basically shows the result. And now let me go to the final part of this talk and talk about the relation between this sum of squares algorithm and Kotz Unigames conjecture. So this is so Kotz receiving the Nebelina Award yesterday. So his conjecture was a certain problem that is known as unique games is NP-hard. And the way I like to think about this conjecture is this other formulation which is not has not been shown to be equivalent, but I consider them as morally equivalent, known as the small set expansion hypothesis. And this is that given a graph, it is NP-hard to distinguish between the following two cases. One case is that the graph contains a small set that is non-expanding. That means all of almost all of the edges that are incident to this set stay inside the set. And the other is that this is not a case that the graph is a small set expander, in the sense that if you look at small enough sets, then almost all of the edges actually go outside the set. So the small set expansion hypothesis, or the, I will treat it as equivalent to the Unigames conjecture, is that it is hard to distinguish whether a graph has a set that almost doesn't expand at all, or the graph is a very good small set expansion. If you look at small enough sets, then all the edges go out, or almost all. And this is a very, I mean, as you can see, and any of you heard a little bit in the talks and in the citation, this this conjecture has many implications to computation complexity, and it also has like fascinating connections, and some of them also Brian O'Donnell's talk later in this conference will discuss. And so you can wrote two surveys, and I guess now also a third one on this conjecture. And Trevi San actually also wrote a very, very wonderful, accessible survey in the bulletin of the AMS. And Ryan Kotz and Aurora talked yesterday, and Ryan will talk few days, I forgot exactly the day. So this is a wonderful conjecture, but of course the million one question is this conjecture actually true? And unlike other conjectures in computation complexity where we are sure what the answer is, but we just don't know how to prove it, here there is really no consensus whether the conjecture is true or false. And this is, I think, a very interesting question. And the main reasons to, so let me tell you kind of a biased personal overview of what we know and don't know about the Unigames conjecture. So the main reason, I think, to believe the Unigames conjecture are two reasons. One reason is that we, the basic reason why we believe any conjecture, we don't know how to prove that it's false. So in the context of Unigames conjecture, we don't know of an algorithm that solves this problem, so maybe conjecturing that it's hard is natural. The second reason is, again, maybe a generic reason, we want the conjecture to be true. So it has all these implications, it gives a very clean picture of a complexity landscape, and in some sense, if by Occam's razor, the most beautiful explanation should be the right one, so if it gives a very clean picture, and we can't refute it, so maybe that's a good reason to believe it. And let's see what people have done trying to attack this conjecture, so by giving an algorithm for this problem. So the first line of attack was a basic semi-definite program. I will not define it, but if you know, say, the Cheeger inequality, if you know Grothendieck inequality, if you know the Lovaas theta function, or you know the Gomans-Williamson algorithm, then this is basically that, or you know, and which is the same algorithm that Immanuel Kant was talking about for the phase recovery problem, then this is the same algorithm applied to the Lee Gehrig's conjecture, and this algorithm has been shown by Arora et al. To actually solve the problem on random instances, which might actually also explain why it's very useful in practice, this algorithm. But in a very beautiful work of Kot and Bishnoi, they showed that there is an instance on which this algorithm actually fails. So it does not, this basic semi-definite program does not refute the Nikem's conjecture, and this instance also implies some very nice metric embedding results, the existence of this, like nice counterexamples of metric embeddings. So this attack doesn't refute the Nikem's conjecture. A second attack is a different algorithm that basically works by eigenspace enumeration. That means that it basically searches. So you take a graph and you're looking for a small set that doesn't expand. So you basically a set that doesn't expand is more or less the same as a vector in the top eigenspace of the adjacency matrix, and you just go and enumerate over everything in that matrix and everything in that space and try to find such a set. And this actually, as shown by Kollar, it actually does solve the same Kot-Bishnoi instance that is problematic for the previous algorithm. And in a work with Arora and Stoyer, we show that it actually solves every instance in sub-exponential time. So basically, a graph cannot be a very good small set expansion and expander and have a very high dimension of this top eigenspace. And the fact that it solves every instance in sub-exponential time already somehow makes the picture, even assuming the Unigame's conjecture is true, to be somewhat more murky. Because before that, you could have hoped that the Unigame's conjecture is true in a very strong sense, which would kind of have like a very clean line. These are the polynomial problems, these are the exponential problems. Now it's more like, even if it's true, it will be, these are the polynomial problems, these are the exponential problems, and these are the problems that are somehow in the middle, the sub-exponential. So it's still very, would have very, very nice implications, would be great if it's true, but it's just a little bit less clean than it would have been, than you could have hoped for. But this algorithm also does not solve the problem, does not refute the Unigame conjecture. There is an instance in work with Gopalan, Hastad, Mekar, Agarwal, and Stoyer. We show that there is an instance that actually does fool this algorithm. This is not exactly yet completely as strong. Subhash's second open problem in his talk was to remove this match qualifier, but it still basically rules out this algorithm. And then, given the title of this talk, the third algorithm I'm going to talk about is the sum of squares algorithm. And as I mentioned, the sum of squares algorithm encapsulates many algorithms in it, which is one of the reasons why I think it might be an optimal meta-algorithm in various contexts. And in particular, it encapsulates both these algorithms in it. So both these algorithms are special case of the sum of squares algorithm. And in some work, we actually show that if you look at all the reasoning in the papers, so if you look at the reasoning in the Kot-Bishnoi paper and the reasoning in our paper that showed problematic instances for those algorithms, then if you just go and look at the proof of these papers, then these proofs are actually low degree sum of squares proofs, or they can be massaged to become low degree sum of squares proofs. And that means that the same paper that showed that the problem is hard for these simple algorithms also inadvertently showed that this problem is easy for the sum of squares algorithm. Because the analysis of the paper actually implies an analysis of the sum of squares algorithm. And the idea is basically that the paper shows, to show that the problem is hard, they show two things. One, they show that the algorithm gives a particular value on this instance, and the second thing is that they show that the true value is different on this instance. But the proof that the true value is different is the sum of squares proofs, and that shows that the sum of squares algorithm actually gives the value that the second proof showed. So basically, this algorithm shows all the solves all the instances that we know that have been proposed as hard instances for this problem. And you can actually show that this is some kind of an approach to solve the problem. So at the moment our situation is that it's not exactly that we don't know of an algorithm that solves unique games conjecture. Maybe we do, maybe we don't. We do know of an algorithm that might solve the unique games conjecture, but we don't have a proof of it. So this is kind of our status of on this thing at this point in time. So basically, to conclude, this sum of squares algorithm is, I think, a very powerful algorithm framework, and there have been several negative results for it, but I think for the right problems, in particular, it has been shown that it cannot solve NP-hard problems, but we never expected it to solve it. But that I think for the right problems, it could actually yield strong results. It already does it in practice, but it could actually also fit in theory. And I think we're just beginning now to build the tools to analyze it for trying to prove low degree convergence results, both for upper bounds and lower bounds. We still have very few in either ones, and although there are some interesting things, including things that I didn't mention, particularly quantum information theory for analyzing the quantum separability problem and entanglement. And this connection, this approach of proof complexity, pseudo-distribution, and approximation algorithms is actually more generic. I instantiated it with the sum of squares, but I think you might be able to instantiate it with other proof systems. So you might be able to define, given a proof system, you might be able to define a distribution-like object also for other proof systems. I don't know that anyone did it, but I think it's possible. And I do believe that this is actually something we will see much progress on over the next few years, and you know, to go out on the limb, and I hope this is not recorded. Maybe, you know, who knows? Maybe on ICM 2018 we'll see a talk on refuting the unique games conjecture by the sum of squares. It's a reasonable possibility. So, that's it.
Thank you. Before I introduce our first invited speaker, Barak. And any questions or comments on his talk? Yes? You have a white mic there.
Oh, it's okay, I'll shout. So you say that SOS generalizes many algorithms,
yes,
which is fine. But where do people, honest to goodness, use SOS as SOS in software?
So I'm probably not the right person to ask it. Maybe Monique, I saw she's here somewhere. She might be the better person. So people use actually, I mean, SOS is implemented, Pablo Porillo implemented MATLAB, and I think there is also some commercial implementations. It's basically very easy to interface it to actual, and I think it's mostly in control system. And there are actually like a little bit of a difference in the TCS perspective is that we usually think of a large N, N as going asymptotically to infinity, where the ways where people actually use it might be with, you know, equations in 16 variables or something like that, because it will very quickly blow up. But I'm not an expert on this.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Yes.
So I think you mentioned about the optimality of this kind of metal groups, but is there any kind of result regarding this?
So we don't really have any result. I think one of the interesting things is that the unique games conjecture itself, if it's true, it implies a very nice optimality result for the degree 2 case. So it actually predicts that going to higher degree will not help you. So if the unique games conjecture itself is true, then for, say, all constraint satisfaction problems, but also for other problems, the degree 2 SOS algorithm is optimal. And I think that regardless, so if it's true, it implies some optimality results, but if it's false via the SOS algorithm, it's still possible that we could salvage an optimality result. But some sense, understanding whether the UGC is true or false is kind of a prerequisite for us, at least for constraint satisfaction problems, to understand this question, to answer this question.
Yeah. We may have time for one more question, so coming. If not, then First, I introduce myself. My name is Heng Gu Lee at Seongyungwan University. I'm one of the organizing committee members, and I was a director for information science division, including matrix theory and computer interface in Korean Math Society, and now I'm director for the division of Math Education. And that's why I think that's why they put me in this session. I will introduce Dr. Boaz Barak. He's working at Microsoft Research now, and he had his PhD program in computer PhD degree from computer science in 2004 from Weizmann Institute of Science, and a bachelor's degree in 1999 from Tel Aviv University. And he has several awards and recognition, including co-winner of Fox 2010 Best Paper Award and a Sloan Foundation Fellowship in 2007, and Association for Computing Machinery Dissertation Award for Best Doctoral Dissertation in Computer Science and Engineering in 2004. And there are many, but I will make it short.
So, thank you.
Let's have one big, more big hand to Dr. Thank you. And we will have about 10 minutes break, then second talk will start at 4. And Dr. Barak, this is a present from our organizing committee.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.